And to another part of the world, as Margaret Warner begins her reports from the Middle East nation of Yemen, a place that has attracted urgent new attention in the U.S.
The call to prayer sounds five times a day in Yemen, as it does across the Arab world. This ancient nation on the Arabian Peninsula boasts a glorious architectural heritage, along with grinding poverty and a new and increasingly deadly franchise of the global al-Qaida network. The outfit calls itself Al-Qaida in the Arabian Peninsula, or AQAP. The top leadership includes two Saudi-born former Guantanamo detainees. While some have taken cover in the capital city, Sana'a, most members are believed to be sheltered in Yemen's rugged tribal provinces, far from central government control. Each week, tribal and community leaders meet on the outskirts of Sana'a to strategize about how to counter the Al-Qaeda presence in their nearby Marib province. They insist they're confronting AQAP where they can, not harboring it.
Al-Qaeda in Marib feels unwanted. They are shunned and hunted. The ethics, morals, and ideas of Al-Qaeda completely contradict the ethics and morals of the tribal system in Marib.
They fault Yemen's central government for shutting their province off to foreign tourists, while still not providing reliable electricity, health services, or schools. It's a combination, they say, that aids Al-Qaeda.
We have a saying in Marib, where the paved road ends, Al-Qaeda begins. And we have a lot of unpaved roads in Marib.
They also blame the United States for their plight.
I would say with confidence that the U.S. re-established Al-Qaeda, as we see some leaders of Al-Qaeda were in Guantanamo and wanted revenge.
And why, if you know where they are and they're shunned, you don't just turn them over to the authorities?
A tribal chief may extend refuge or help someone until he sees clear evidence that this person has committed a crime.
At his home in Sana'a, former prime minister and presidential advisor Abdul Karim al-Ilariani says there's something more at work.
There is a traditional system of accepting anyone who comes and says, I need you to protect me. But I believe with regard to Al-Qaeda, I can't imagine that a tribe will shelter Al-Qaeda for free. It's not a free ride. And I'm afraid they have money.
We came to Yemen to explore why this country has emerged as home base to the most effective new Al-Qaeda offshoot. And we found a contradiction. Ordinary Yemenis seem very welcoming to outsiders. Yet from the medieval crusades to the anti-Soviet campaign in Afghanistan and beyond, Yemenis have punched above their weight in waging jihad abroad. We asked the former prime minister to explain the contradiction.
Yemenis are well-known traders, well-known migrants. So being traders, you have to be tolerant. Being an immigrant, you have to accept the other.
But when fellow Muslims are under attack, he said, Yemenis have always answered the call.
The concept of continuous jihad is not a Yemeni phenomenon. It's not very entrenched in Yemen. However, when the call comes, they do.
Squarely in that tradition was Nasser al-Bahri, who went to Afghanistan in the mid-90s and became a bodyguard for Osama bin Laden.
He was so calm. He was so self-confident. He was, for me, the only and best person who could confront the United States.
Though out of the action now, al-Bahri still considers the U.S. to be the world's biggest menace to Muslims. And he says America is exaggerating the strength of AQAP.
Al-Qaeda in Yemen is weak. The real Al-Qaeda people in Yemen do not exceed 200, maybe a few more. The media makes it much bigger.
Yet they were good enough to almost bring down a U.S. airliner on Christmas.
This doesn't mean that they have a huge number of people. They need only an idea. training, preparation, then implementation.
One of AQAP's ideas is recruiting radicalized young Muslims from the West, sometimes using Sana'a's world-famous Arabic language schools as unwitting cover. The would-be Christmas Day bomber, Nigerian student Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab, showed up for classes here, but dropped out after 3 weeks to pursue his deadly mission. U.S. and Yemeni officials say, however, that most of AQAP's foot soldiers are drawn from local families who struggle, whether in the countryside or the city, to live on an average of $2 a day. Now they fear the desperation will grow as terrorism takes a toll on Yemen's all-important tourist trade. The medieval stone and plaster structures of Sana'a's old city used to draw world travelers to look and to spend. Usually, how many sales would you make a day?
$200, $300, it depends. Sometimes more and sometimes less.
And now?
And now, maybe 200 a month.
Shopkeeper Karim Al-Faki took us on a tour to show the wider impact.
Last month and this month, it went down. But before, it was busy. Like, so they sell to locals. There is no money coming from outside the country.
So all of this, in a way, you're saying is a little deceptive. There's not enough really happening here.
That's right. See, too much stuff, few people to buy.
Another risk, too few teachers or jobs for the legions of restless young men in Yemen's overcrowded and underfunded schools.
For me, myself, I cannot memorize all the names of the students.
High school English teacher Amin Al-Andrisi, mobbed by his students during a break, feels he's letting them down.
You can get in some classes more than 80 students. Sometimes we are reaching 120. Yeah. You can't believe that. No, you believe me. You can ask any students here.
And he fears Yemen will let them down too when it comes to getting a college education or a decent job.
You know, you are teaching teenagers who are between 16 to 19 years old. This is the age which the students, they think themselves that they are very strong and very powerful and they can do whatever they want.
Whatever they want in a country that too often doesn't provide good choices for its youth.
Margaret will continue her reports from Yemen later this week.